remain silent and be at rest and ready to hear the still small voice of your Holy Spirit speaking us through every part of this morning's worship. You forgive and cleanse, Lord, our iniquities, our sins, anything that would impede the seed of your word from not just penetrating, not just growing roots, not just growing leaves, but bearing fruit to your honor and glory. We pray for that blessing, Lord, that we can hear with clarity and respond with a willing heart.
Amen.
For these blessings we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, church family.
Good morning, brother. This
morning's opening hymn is hymn number 518, Standing on the Promises. Hymn number 518. Church budget, and it's on God Never Takes a Break. July is a summer month perfect for vacations. Some of us are getting ready to spend some leisure time at the lake, in the mountains, or even a foreign country. We disconnect, leaving behind our work, hectic schedules, minutiae of the daily grind. Hopefully, we return refreshed and ready for a new cycle of work, family, and our routine. Many know John 3:16 by heart. Its core message is that God loves humanity and came to serve it. From the moment humanity chose sin in the Garden of Eden, God never had a day off from work. Every day, the Creator of the universe shows up for work by healing, protecting, advising via the Holy Spirit, admonishing and hoping for wise choices, crying and smiling. Can you imagine the 9-to-5 grind of God's schedule?
24/7.
The sheer magnitude of God's presence in our universe at all times and being of service to a fallen humanity, overwhelming yet encouraging. He is there for us.
Amen.
We will count on Him at all times. Let us remember God in the midst of our vacation preparations. God never takes a day off or a break. He serves humanity 24 hours a day, every day, until his son returns to gather us. And for those that wish to give a faith offering, the plates are in the back of the church. Yeah. The basket, the thingamajig. So, let's bow our heads for prayer. Dear Father in heaven, thank you that you sent your son here to die for us, and that you never, ever take a day off. That you are always there to guide us, protect us, and to show us the way. Please be with us today and help us to think wholeheartedly and to pray continually on our daily walk. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
And today's Lamb's offering also is for the church flower fund. That goes for the funerals, weddings, and the whatnot to help when you have a passing of a church member, so that the church family, show our support. And today's children's story is going to be brought to us by Holly Bailey Wilson.
Yeah. So I'm coming up here, since we're not having the children anyway right in front, and I would like to have some pictures here for you all to see. So this makes it easiest for me. So I'm going to be connecting up here, and hopefully we'll get our picture here soon. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's another beautiful day out today, isn't it? All right. I believe we should have it popping up here shortly. Okay, we are ready for our children's story.
What is that?
That is exactly what I want you to figure out. Can anyone looking at this tell me what they think it is?
Tadpoles.
She got it.
All right, it looks really dark. Where do you think they're at? Okay, they're in a 5-gallon bucket.
Oh.
This should help you see them a little bit better, correct? Can you see those?
Wow. I wondered why they were in a circle.
So I am going to tell you how these happened to be there, okay? This was 5 years ago. I had to go back to my Facebook albums, and it was back in 2015, so this was 5 years ago. And at that time, for those of you who have been over to our place where we have the gazebo, for like 22 years, we had a swimming pool there. And before winter sets in the fall, you have to put a winter cover on your pool. And that winter cover will collect water. Now, we also put a leaf cover over that because we'd have leaves fall into it, and that way we could pull the leaves out and then drain the water. Well, when spring came in 2015, we had our collection of leaves and we had our water. And my husband would say, like the middle of May, oh, let's take off the winter cover. And I'm saying, no, not yet, because he doesn't clean the pool. And it just adds more work. And we're definitely not ready to swim the middle of May. It's still too cold for that. So let's hold off a little bit. Well, we held off for an extensive period of time, and it was now getting close to the beginning, middle of June. And I know that because it was right before we were going to be going to camp meeting. And I happened to walk out there with my mom, and I looked in the winter cover with its leaves, and what do you think I saw? I saw, it felt like, gazillions of tadpoles.
A winter cover shouldn't be on in June.
And so, I was horrified. I was horrified. Now, what would most people have done?
Dumped them.
They would have just taken and dumped it like they generally do. Come what may, whatever happens to those tadpoles, not my concern, I don't care. Well, that's not how I felt.
Yeah.
And so I was like, what are we going to do with these literally thousands upon thousands of tree frog tadpoles, because we have no swamp and water by our place, not even close. But tree frogs found our swimming pool and thought it was the greatest place to reproduce. And so, long story short, we ended up skimming as many of them as we could and put them in 5-gallon buckets. And the nearest...
One bucket.
Oh, many buckets. Okay. Yeah, it was definitely more than one bucket. And the nearest swamp was about, what, 4 miles away, dear?
Yes.
About 4 miles away. And then we had those leaves, and we knew there's no way we could get them out of all those leaves. So we had a stock tank that wasn't being used, and we used our net, and we pulled those leaves out, put it in the stock tank, and along with the multiple 5-gallon buckets of tadpoles, and it was easier once we got the leaves out too, because we could skim and scoop a little bit easier. And we took them multiple times to the swamp and dumped.
Yay.
Now, that still wasn't quite all of them, and so we had to drain the cover to the swimming pool, and because we might have missed some, when it came through the tube, we even put a screen at the end of the tube that was so that any of them that happened to come through there, I could rescue from the screen, put in water, and take to the swamp. And I literally, sometimes the screen with the force of the water kind of opened up and there would be some in the grass and I could see their shiny bellies and I would be searching in the grass, finding these tadpoles, picking them out and putting them in the water. That was a really tedious opening of our pool cover that year. And when we got to the very, we had cleared out everything, and in the very middle, because we had an inner tube, there was a little dip of water left over that we couldn't reach when we were doing all of this. And when we pulled that tube over, there was probably another dozen to 15 tadpoles. So with those, I actually, because my husband had never seen the metamorphosis of a tadpole to a frog. And so I had a little aquarium, and I got all the seaweed and the plant life that they needed, and I put that dozen to 15 in that aquarium so that he could actually see the process of a tadpole here as it came out of a swimming pool cover. You see what's developing there? See how it's developing its back legs? Now it's gaining some features that are looking a little bit more frog-like. That is when it's almost ready to leave the water. You see how it really looks like a frog, but it still has its tail? And there it was. This was the day before this one came out of the water. And so it just found some of the seaweed to sit on. It really quit swimming around, and it was almost as though I could watch, because they go from gills to lungs.
Wow.
And so you could see that day, it was almost like an adjustment period day for it, where it just kind of sat there and was adjusting to the changes that was going to take place.
Wow.
And by the next day, it's up on the glass. But do you notice that it still has the tail?
Yeah.
I've understood that they don't eat for that period of time. It's like a day or two. And what their body does is it absorbs the nutrients from the tail as the tail gets smaller. And it makes that adaptation between water and air. That was the next day.
Oh, that's so awesome.
Can you believe the tail? Just like gone. I mean, how quickly.
Nobody cut it off.
No. It gets absorbed. And so there it is, and this little stick in there. And at this point, I'm looking at it and saying, it's ready to be released. You notice how the skin looks drier too?
Yeah.
So at that point, it's ready to be released. Now, there it is, out in nature.
So cute.
And they're just tiny, so cute. So it's a really awesome process to watch. Now, you may ask, What spiritual lessons do we have to gain from this? Well, for one, this to me is a perfect, this and the next picture is a perfect picture of a spiritual walk.
Yeah.
Now, if you look, I brought these tadpoles in at the same time. They were in the same environment and in the same tank, all right? But you notice the one on the left is still tadpole with just the beginning of legs. And they have their back legs for a long time
before
they get their front legs. When the front legs come out, the change is very quick. But they will have those back legs for quite a long time before the transformation takes place, the metamorphosis. So look at this one on the right. It's just about ready.
Just about ready.
And here they are, side by side.
Oh.
Really shows the difference, doesn't it? Now, again, how important is it for us to realize that even though we may be at the same church, we may be in the same home, we may be in the same community, but we all develop at different rates. Okay? And it is not any one of our jobs to judge someone because they do not look like us.
That's true.
And this is a perfect natural lesson showing us that this occurs. And so leaving that to God, to the Holy Spirit, to make the changes at the right time for that person, but providing them with the necessary environment to do so.
Yes.
So, as I contemplate, that is one of the lessons I took from this. Another lesson I took from this, here it is, released after it's, you know, reached its potential to be outdoors. Now, had I just discarded them, they would have perished, and they would have never been able to reach their potential, correct? And so let's remember, we do need to provide the necessary opportunities and environment for growth and development to take place, right?
Yeah.
And last I took from this is if I was so willing to go out of my way, and boy did I inconvenience myself, to save, and Bruce, to save these tadpoles that so many people would think are totally insignificant. And by the way, I don't know if there was a population explosion in that area where we dumped them all the next year, so we were responsible for it. But if I was so willing to inconvenience myself to save their lives, how much more should we be willing to inconvenience ourselves to save the lives of those around us by sharing the good news of Jesus?
Amen.
So that is what I took from my situation 5 years ago, and I just hope that it can be a blessing to you as
that
well.
It is a blessing.
Shall we pray? Our dearest Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that you teach us through nature, that you give us glimpses of your love and your persistence and the potential that all of us have with you living in us. We thank you and praise you for your goodness, your love, and the nature that you have abundantly blessed us with. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And now if you'll join me in kneeling as we approach the Lord in prayer, as we sing 672 in the hymnals. In the name of prayer. Precious Heavenly Father, We come before you this morning in prayer as we ask for prayers for Pastor and our church family and our surrounding communities so that we can open our hearts to hear what the pastor has to say and hoping to help the touch the pastor's lips to say what he needs to say that we can need to hear. Please be with us this day and thank you for this glorious Sabbath day that you've given us. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
And now we have scripture reading brought to us by Keith Rose.
Our scripture reading is Luke 8, 7, 8, and 14. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and choked it. But others fell on good ground, sprang up and yielded a crop 100-fold. When he had said these things, he cried, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." Now the ones that fell among thorns, and those who, when they have heard, go out and are choked with cares, riches, and pleasures of life, and bring no fruit to maturity.
And now we'll be blessed with a special music brought to us by Larry, Debbie, and
James
and Elijah. Hunter.
We're going to give this a try. When they come and visit Grandma, this is what we sing. And so I don't know how shy they'll become, but we're going to give this a try. They wanted to do special music for us.
Jesus loves me, this I know.
Sabbath, church?
Sabbath.
Do you believe what the Bible tells us so?
Amen.
Jesus loves us. What a wonderful way to begin the sermon. And praise the Lord that if a human being can be filled with love for God's creation, that little tadpoles matter. Jesus brought it with himself this morning. You are worth more than many tadpoles.
That's right.
And if a human being can care for one struggling in the grass, certainly God cares for you and I.
Amen.
So thank you, Lord, for blessing our hearts already with many sermons. And I pray that mine can supplement and complement what you've already been telling us. And we've been blessed to hear. As your word is being preached, Father, help us to hear loud and clear that you love us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
This morning, we're going to now begin to kind of start landing the plane as we're reaching the third soil in the parable of the sower. And this morning's message is simply entitled Monopoly, and it's named after the game. Have any of you ever played this game before, Monopoly? It's a game that you need to, you have? All right. It's a game that you need to pray before you play, because you could get quite competitive. If you are competitive, you know,
I wasn't.
Not competitive, I'd like to meet you. If you're not, I have yet to meet someone that's not. I certainly like to win. And my wife and I have had a lot of fun throughout the years because she likes to win too. So it's fun when your love allows you to lose. And you can tell your wife, I'll let you win on that one, honey, because I love you. But Monopoly, you know the game. What's the whole goal of that game? I mean, the title of the game tells you. What is your objective in that game? Monopolize everything. Take control of the entire board, so that no matter what where people land, they pay you money. And that is like, yeah, I control the whole thing. And God providentially has been allowing my wife and I to get quite acquainted with gardens. You guys' gardens. You guys know that our little garden, our little bean plant died. So we're in the process of figuring out if we want to go through the trauma of starting another garden at the risk of it dying too. But we were at the McKinley's helping them weed, and a lot of food for thought came from that experience.
Amen.
Laura mentioned that there's a chunk of land that she has to maintain, and it's difficult to kind of rotate yourself throughout it. And the day that we arrived, she pointed out to a part of their garden where they had planted beets. And it was difficult to see the beets because the weeds had taken over. And that's the thing about weeds. Weeds don't want to simply cohabitate with the beets and the cucumbers. The weeds want to monopolize the entire garden. If you let one weed in your garden, it will take over the entire garden. Weeds are not saying to you, listen, can we have that section over there? Can we have like 80% of your garden? What weeds want is the entire thing. Every inch of your tilled soil, weeds want every part of it. In Luke 8:7, Jesus says, and some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and choked it. Jesus is using quite a violent word there. Choked the plants. Kills it. Weeds don't want cucumbers and tomatoes and corn in your garden. Weeds want more weeds in your garden. And should you dare to plant anything else in your garden that is not weeds, the weeds will try to kill it or choke it. Providentially, like I've been telling you, these are things that are just affirming the sermon sequence that the Lord has been leading us. This past week, my wife looked at our community center where we're staying at, and we're thankful for. And my wife, being who she is, she made the house front of the community center pretty. She planted a lot of beautiful flowers there. She likes colors. And I'm glad for that. But then she looked at what the front of the community center looked like, and she's like, I wanna express gratitude for what the church is doing for us. And I want to see how we can also help the church look pretty. So we teamed up with Michelle, and this week we went to the part of the front of the church where the church sign is. And we didn't realize that to the right of the sign was a weed growing.
It looks like a wolfish.
And I don't know what it is, but if you know Bob Nelson, he's like taller than me. And this is Bob Nelson's height, and the weed was taller than him. And it was full of thorns. My wife tried to pull it out.
It's a wolfish.
And it has thorns.
Right. It's very pokey.
And extremely territorial. And it was getting ready to expand with spores and seeds. And if we had not pulled that out, what would happen? What could we expect next year?
Well, many more.
You wouldn't see our sign anymore. The weeds would cover the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And Bob showed up to do something else, and he saw the lean trying to struggle with this thing, trying to figure out where to grab this thing, and Bob said, I'll be right back. And being a man of the soil, he didn't come with gloves, he came with a shovel. And just scooped the thing out. And I said, Bob, can I take a picture with this? Because providentially, this Sabbath I'm talking about weeds. Weeds in the heart, weeds in the family, and weeds in the church. You know, no one planted that there. And maybe Bob, when he looked at it, he did a double take. He's like, where did that come from? Where did that come from? Something so big can go unnoticed for so long. Apparently, things that grow gradually, we don't perceive until someone says, we're trying to take that out, and then for the first time you're noticing. And for me, the experience of family, of my parents as a teenager, being pointed out things by my parents, things that were so obvious that I had to do a double take and say, wait, hold up a second, that's inside of me? Being married, having your spouse point out weeds that you never saw and have just grown so much. You know, we had an awesome discussion this past Wednesday at prayer meeting. And if you haven't been coming to prayer meeting, I want to encourage you to do so. It's going to bless you. We talked about what a true friend does. There's a proverb that says, faithful are the wounds of a friend, but deceitful are the kisses of an enemy. Open rebuke is better than secret love. Those two verses are followed in the book of Proverbs. And Bob was thankful that at that moment when he came, Dalene said, Bob, can you help me take this out? Something that he had not noticed, but that needed to come out. Because if this weed did not come out, it would take over and the church would not be seen. And really, when we talk about this is a parable, I have to look at my heart. I can't look and say, well, the church certainly must have weeds. The only weeds that can come to the church come inside my heart. And as Holly appealed to us in the children's story, the only heart God is going to hold me accountable to, you know whose heart that is? My own heart. And so if there are weeds that I perceive to be in any family, any relationship, or any church, as we've already gone providentially through that sermon series, we need to make sure that it's not a plank that is blinding me and only me making me notice specks in other people's eyes. There could be a weed inside of me that unless someone else brings it to my attention, I will never see it. And someone pointing out a weed in my life, how should I respond to someone pointing out a weed?
Thank you.
Amen. Amen. The uniqueness of the third soil is the exhausted part of maintaining weeds out. In soil one, once you till the ground, the soil does not untill itself the next day. Once you till the soil, once you've aerated it and broken up the hard crust, it doesn't untill itself. Once you remove stones out of the soil, new stones don't naturally just grow underneath. But with the third soil, when you weed, you're going to have to weed again, and you're going to have to weed again, and you're going to have to weed again. Our girls are asking, when are we going to go in and help Laura weed the beets again? Because the weed spent, how many hours was that? Like two, three hours? I know that by now, it's been a week and a half, 2 weeks. I'm almost confident new weeds are trying to take over that portion of the beets again. And those have to be weeded again and again and again. When I was in my journey as a Christian, I thought I had taken care of my bad temper problem. 25 years ago. And then I realized that I needed to take care of it not on a yearly basis, not on a monthly basis, not on a weekly basis. How often did Paul have to diet to himself? The weeds will grow in your heart and they start very little. And it's the mature Christian that as we begin to go from the tadpole with the tail or the tadpole with the front legs to the tadpole with no tail, one of the short telltale signs that you are starting to mature is when you yourself can begin to identify weeds when they're still in the baby stage. Because as a young Christian, I focus on the big stuff. Like, Lord, I need to yank this big mama out. Done, you know. Today, praise the Lord. And Satan was also praising the Lord with me because I was completely neglectful of the hundreds of little ones that were still in my heart. Weeds are opportunistic. It's interesting that for the past couple of prayer meetings, we've been asking for the Lord for prayer. Weeds don't seem to have a problem asking for rain. They survive. They have an ability. They are just, as I put it here, they are aggressive, relentless, merciless, and boy, do they grow quick. For not receiving any manure, for not receiving any kind of attention, boy, do weeds grow quick. It's so hard to take out. So this third soil experience is not a one-time experience. It's not a you're baptized experience. It's not that you've overcome this or you've overcome that. In a real sense, praise the Lord, that tadpoles one day can say, I'm a frog. But we Christians will never be able to say, I'm done weeding. I'm done weeding. My garden is set. The day that I stop weeding is the day that I've surrendered my garden to the weeds. Luke 8:14, when Jesus explains this, Jesus identifies for us three kinds of weeds. The universal weeds in the human heart. Luke 8:14 says, now the ones that fell among thorns are those who, when they have heard, go out and are choked, are asphyxiated, are drowned with cares, riches, and pleasures of life, and bring no fruit to what?
Maturity.
See, this was a huge moment of realization. Why Satan stopped trying to take me out of the church? Satan knew, okay, I'm going to let you stay. He tried to take me out through work pressures, Sabbath. He tried to take me out through dating girls that were not interested in the Lord at all. He tried many friendships that pressured me to compromising and eventually leaving the church. But I stayed, and finally said, okay, so you can stay as long as you don't bear fruit. Mm-hmm. See, Satan tries to keep people out of the church by taking the word out. You know, as they're watching online, as they have opportunities to hear sermons, as family members share books, they'll hear stuff, but just like in that first parable, the birds ate it up. There's never a chance for the seed to actually take any kind of root inside your heart. That's the world, the secular world. But the majority of this parable dominates people that are here. People that are here, but with stones, with a superficial religion. But should you begin to experience a maturing, a deepening of roots, you begin to read books, and you begin to get depth, and you begin to teach, and you begin to preach, and you begin to give Bible studies, Satan is like, I don't mind any of those things as long as I don't see fruit inside of you. Satan will leave you alone as long as you let the weeds impede you from producing fruits. Satan doesn't care if you have a stalk, if you have roots, or if you have leaves, as long as you don't have fruits.
That's right.
And that's what the goal of the weeds are, to prevent the plant from finally reaching full maturation. And a full maturation is when a plant produces fruits and allows those fruits to ripen to full maturity as well. And if you're wondering what these fruits are, Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23 are pretty clear as to what these fruits are. Love, joy, peace, patience, gentleness, kindness, self-control. Whenever I gave Bible studies to people, and especially to those that felt pretty good on themselves, pretty good about themselves, whenever I would read the fruits of the Spirit, actually it's the fruit of the Spirit, because they all grow as a unit in one package. You want to take a wild guess? Which one was the common denominator that everybody felt they lacked?
Patience.
100% of the time, people, when I would ask them, but I would like, but how can you be patient if you don't have joy or gentleness or love? Just like the Ten Commandments, you can't break one without breaking the other. And you can't just have a lack in patience. That may be the most noticeable one. God wants you to experience the joy of having the Holy Spirit producing you these kinds of fruits. Because these kinds of fruits will bless everybody that you come in contact with. It is not something that you're going to have to try or put effort into. People will be blessed because they will see not your fruits, but Jesus in you. Because that's what the seed is, the Word of God. You cannot get the seeds of the Spirit without the Word of God in your heart, and without it being unhindered. This idea that, you know, these three weeds grow and expand and choke and take over, I see it as a cycle. It's not like A, B, C. I see this as an ongoing, non-ending cycle from my own personal experience and by helping other people identify why they don't mature, why they lack fruit in their life. Who looks for cares in their lives? Who likes to be anxious, right? No one does. But we get anxious in this planet just because we're in this planet. You have fires in California. You have earthquakes. You have Japanese bees coming over and wondering what they're going to do to the bees in America. So the news are a great place for you to get cares, right? Watch the news for 30 minutes. You'll have plenty of things to be anxious about. Watch the Weather Channel, you have plenty of things to be anxious about. And so we try to mitigate it. We got a provoking source of anxiety, and we try to escape it. I need something that will calm me down. But most pleasures on planet Earth cost money. So we have to get something that we can afford, something to take care of something. And once Satan gets us spinning this wheel, once he puts us, like we put those gerbils inside those little wheels with a little carrot over here, he'll get you running and running and panting and exhausted and cramped and burnt out. And when will you ever get the carrot?
Never.
And Jesus says, this will kill you. This will dominate your imaginations. This will dominate when you go to bed, and this will dominate your mind when you wake up, and this will dominate you all throughout your entire day. It will dominate you so much, you will just not have room for me. Because this cycle expands and expands just like weeds. Weeds will not stay put where you see them today. Wherever you see weeds today, they will be all over the place in just a month. A matter of a month, you'll see weeds where you did not expect them. So a friend of mine that lived in, I'm going to say another state, were very frustrated with their neighbors. They kept their yard manicured, weed-free. Their neighbors, not so. And their complaint was this. There are weeds, I didn't know this, there are weeds that don't travel outwardly. They don't travel by throwing their seed. They travel underground. They throw roots somewhere else and then pop up somewhere else. So you think you've yanked the weed and it's done, but no, it has like hundreds of other children ready to sprout somewhere else. And these neighbors had such weeds that no matter how much this neighbor weeded, the neighbor's weeds would come into their yard. Your weeds can get into someone else's garden too. You know, I want you to see and know that there's no one high and mighty standing in front of you. It's someone that is in that journey of trying to go from the tail to no tail to hind legs and front legs. And this past Wednesday, we had a sensitive discussion as a church. And I spoke with passion. And it doesn't matter what the intentions are, the outcome of that was that I wounded a sister. And the Holy Spirit said, that's a weed. That's a weed. You can ignore it. You can excuse it. You can justify it. Or you can acknowledge it, confess it, and allow me to take it out.
Amen.
And I'm thankful that throughout life I've learned that as a pastor, I don't need to model to you pride. What I need to model for you requires that I crucify self on a moment-by-moment basis. And I'm thankful that that night I could kneel before the Lord and say, I'm thankful that I apologize and I ask for forgiveness. Because had I not, that weed of pride could justify the weed of pride in someone else's heart. My weeds will not just stay in my garden. If I am not diligent, I can affect my spouse. I can affect my children. And in turn, I can affect my church. Is this not true, church? Are you following?
Amen.
Do we want a weed-free church?
Yes.
Then I need to be diligent with my heart. And I'm being transparent with you so that when I tell you things like pray for me, I'm not just trying to be false, humble. There's a hymn that I remember when I first heard it in mission college. It made me cry. It says, I need the prayers of those I love. I love that hymn. And I need the prayers of those I love just as much as you do. And I appreciated Holly's story this morning because patience, the fruits of the Spirit, patience, to give each other room to grow and be patient with the stumblings and fumblings that others make, reminding ourselves, did I not stumble myself in this journey of growth? Did I not make mistakes that the Lord was merciful and pitiful and compassionate with me? And if Jesus was compassionate with me, I should be compassionate with others and treat them in the same dignity that God has treated me. Matthew 13:22 says, now he who receives seed among thorns is he who hears the word and cares of this world. And Matthew adds a powerful word. He doesn't just put riches, because sometimes these messages, we used to kind of take cheap jabs at people that have means. But Jesus is not about that. We have Job and Abraham as individuals who are godly and holy and righteous and have been blessed with means. So Matthew adds a powerful insight that applies that puts everybody in the same plane. A deceitfulness of riches. This is a key word. Riches are deceitful for more than just reasons that we have time to explore this morning. Earthly riches seduces those who covet it, infects those who pursue it, and deceives those who possess it. Matthew's gospel adds that word that makes that statement of Jesus, that weed, the part of that cycle, applicable to everybody. Because the riches, we think, well, that's the upper class. I'm poor. Praise the Lord. I don't have to worry about that weed. Not so. With Matthew's gospel, when he talks about the deceitfulness of riches, can poor people be deceived by riches as well?
That's right.
I used to work at a coffee shop, And the owners were Greek. It's a family-owned coffee shop in Pennsylvania. And one corner, sometimes we were bad, they had no business at all, but there was one corner of that shop that was always with customers, and it was a section where the Pennsylvania lottery tickets were sold. You know how many wealthy people came to the lottery machine?
Probably none.
None. You know how many poor people came?
All of them.
You know, Pennsylvania would peddle the lottery by saying, you know, it helps the seniors. It helps the seniors. You know who was the majority of the customers that we got?
Seniors.
Seniors.
Ooh.
Poor people can be just as deceived by riches as wealthy people. Who's rich? Who's rich? This statistic is old. I got this from a book that was gifted by ADRA, ASI, some 10 years ago, when the tourists went out to Sacramento for an ASI convention. And I was walking the booths after closing. I had filled out a raffle ticket and I won a book by ADRA. And it floored me because at that time, I was willingly serving the Lord for no income at all, thinking that I was poor. And that book opened my eyes to the fact that I actually was rich. That book, one of the opening statistics said that if you own 3 pairs of shoes, you are in the top 5-7% wealthiest people in the planet. How many pairs of shoes are in your closet? Bruce, stop looking at Holly. Take care of your own garden, brother. How many pairs of shoes are in my closet today? Because if you have more than 3, your percentage in the wealthiest people on the world goes up.
6, 6, 6, 6.
We have to rethink what rich is. I thought for many years that I was poor, but our family had food in the fridge, and there was not a day that we did not eat food. We were wealthy. Because when I went to places in El Salvador, when I visited places in Turkey, when I went to other parts of the world, and all you need to do is just watch some documentaries highlighting other parts of Asia. There you will see poverty. There you will see people literally with 2 sticks and a plastic tarp tucked into a side of a mountain, and that's their home. And their shower is a creek that runs next to it. And their bathroom is this puddle next to this little hut. That's poverty. I thought I was poor because of the neighborhood that I lived in and because of the income that we had in this country till the Lord sent me to that rehab center in Bolivia. There I saw poverty. There I saw what it truly was to be poor. Little children that would come to this drug rehab center and their entire clothes, they were wearing it. And it was t-shirts that they had gotten from some Catholic missions some years ago with holes and patches and zippers that didn't work and shoes that were mismatched with no shoelaces that they kept losing. And that's all they had. When I came back to the States, I looked at my closet that I had clothes that still had tags in it, and I felt good about it. I felt ashamed and embarrassed. And I took chunks of my closet and I went to the community center and said, other people need to wear this. I can't pretend to have so much and be callous about the needs of others. That's why we need to be involved in missions.
Amen.
That's why as a church, we need to take opportunities to look for opportunities to send our young people overseas so that they can come back aware with a reference point of how wealthy we are in this country. So much that we take for granted. So I can tell you right now this morning, if you have a car out there in the parking lot, if you came in a car this morning, you are uber wealthy. If 3 pairs of shoes put you in the top, over the top 10% of wealthiest people in the world, imagine what having a car, where that puts you. And if you and I are wealthy, then certainly riches, the deceitfulness of riches, can pollute my heart. It's not just simply that we want money. There's a deeper, deeper yearning. I spent time with the Lord this week asking him why. Why does riches have such a stronghold on us? And it's subtle. It's not simply, oh, I want a big house. I just want a medium one, Lord. Doesn't have to be a new car, just a nice, not so new car. Can we have 3 more? Can we have more than 1 house? Can I have? There's a reason behind it. And he begins in Genesis chapter 1, verses 29 and 30. When God said, see, I have given you, this is God speaking to humanity, I have given you, pay attention to what God does here. I have given you every herb that yields seed, which is on the face of the earth, and how many trees?
Every tree.
So humanity, in this context of no sin in this planet, that we have very little information about, we get this insight. When God looks at the human race, he tells them, this is going to be your food. Every green herb and every tree. Whose feet yields food to you, it shall be for food. Verse 30, also to every beast of the earth, to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps on the earth in which there is life, I have given green herb for food. In this context, they're going to ask me how to, this explains how the ecosystems worked back then. I just believe the word of God for what it says.
Amen, I do too.
And in this context, apparently, being able to eat from trees was only a prerogative that was given to the human race.
Amen.
Humans were distinguished from the animal world by one aspect. Humans ate from trees. So the temptation of Satan, Lucifer, was brilliant. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? Who are the only ones that were not to eat of trees? Who are the only ones that were not supposed to eat from trees?
Animals.
What is Lucifer pushing and insinuating to eat? You are inferior, aren't you? You are like an animal, right? You're like me. Because that's all you can see is an animal. A serpent. We are alike, aren't we? We are at the same level, aren't we? And Eve is not just being caused to doubt what God has said. What Satan is trying to provoke, to insert inside of Eve's mind, is a desire to exalt self. By pushing humanity down, he's trying to cause Eve to respond by saying, no, 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 I'm not an animal. I am not less than. And this is the drive behind the pursuit of wealth. It is an innate, built-in inferiority complex that we've gotten from sin. We believe we are not enough. Identity and worth were questioned. Are you like the beasts of the earth, or the birds, or the creeping things? You must be. God told you that you could not eat from every tree. You are not enough, and God has made you like this. You are not enough, and God has made you inferior. Satan had to set a ground. Satan had to set a reason, a response, a reaction, so that Eve could be seduced. Not simply in ignoring what God has said, but why? Why ignore what God has said? Because God is making me inferior? God has made me not enough? You can be more. This is what became so seductive when he said, you shall be like gods. Satan pushed down to get a reaction so that then he could go and say, no, 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 don't just be human. Why couldn't you just be God? And because Eve was already pushing to exalt self, it didn't take much for her to push a little further and embrace the lie. You can be more, you can be God, obey my words, and you'll be more than you could ever think imaginable. But the pursuit to be more than what God had created us to be choked God's word and left humanity spiritually bankrupt and fruitless. And that's what riches do for us. This is the deceitfulness of riches. We equate having much to being much. Therefore, if I have nothing, I am nothing. My parents loved my brother and I, and in their abject poverty that we came from South America, which is not abject, I should have said relative poverty, because there were definitely people poorer than us, even when we were dirt poor in Bolivia. My parents didn't feel comfortable when they would see other individuals or family members have more.
Mm.
Because it made them feel less.
Mm.
When you are less educated, when your income does not measure up, when your house doesn't look like, when your cars are not, then our society pushes for that.
Mm.
Our society pushes. The push for education is not for you to be educated, it's for you to be rich. The push for education is for you to make a certain income. And every culture is infected by the deceitfulness of riches, because every culture is affected by sin.
That's right.
The human heart is continually striving to reclaim what was lost in the Garden of Eden. Because we embrace the lie that it's not just that I am not enough, it's that God is not enough. I have to become enough. I have to have something. I have to be a somebody. And what makes me a somebody? How much I have. How much I have. You know, the gospel completely eradicates that lie. And God did it not by written words, but by the living word.
Amen.
Jesus came as a nothing, but yet possessed everything. He was and is our everything. But outwardly, Isaiah 53 says, he had nothing that would attract us. You know, when we have the cars we have, because the cars we had before broke, we drove them to the death. I still have my wife's college car, 1999 Corolla, that died about a year and a half ago. I remember going to church with these brand new people that were coming to our church after an evangelistic series, and they had visited other churches. And as I got into my 1999, and you could tell it was a couple of decades old, the paint started to fade, all these things. To me, I was happy. There's no car payments. Hallelujah. Praise
Amen.
The Lord.
Amen.
That's true riches right there. That's a beautiful car. That's a Corvette to me. No payments?
Yeah.
That's a Lotus. When I went to getting my car, one of the ladies looked at the other lady, and she didn't know that I heard her say this. Well, how refreshing to see a pastor and I get into a Cadillac Escalade. See, in the Detroit area, in the poorest sections of the Detroit area, the churches that flourish are those that preach a prosperity gospel.
Mercy.
A perversion of what the gospel truly offers.
That is
the deceitfulness of riches can affect even theology.
That's right.
We have to fight this, because sin has robbed our identity in God and our worth to our Creator. That's the deceitfulness of riches. You are worth nothing until you have a lot. Because having is being. That's the lie. That's the deception. We're going to read these verses backwards. 1 Timothy chapter 6, we're going to start with verse 10 and work our way back to verse 6. For the love of money is a root. I never saw that before until this week when I saw Bob Nelson put that weed. The love of money is that weed. That weed that Jesus spoke of. That will consume and try to take over your entire garden. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from the faith in their greediness and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation and a snare and into many foolish and harmful lusts, which, that's not just this word, the identical word used in the garden by Jesus. The weeds choke, suffocate, drown. The love of money. You don't have to be rich to love money. A lot of poor people love money too. I was coming out of AY at the 13th Street Church in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, and my good friend, Juan Carlos, he was the son of a Cuban refugee who was tired of being poor. Tired of being poor, tired of his dad driving a hoopty. And he got seduced by selling drugs.
Oh no.
He recruited me after an AY meeting on a Friday night. Coming out of church, he approached me and said, Ariel, I want you to work for me. You already live in the part that I've been assigned to sell. You want to sell for me? I'll give you Sabbaths off, don't worry.
Oh my.
And the fact that we go to church, I know I can trust you. And he dug into his pocket and he rolled out a wad of cash and he put it in my hand and he said, look at it. Because there were some fake drug dealers that would put a $20 bill on top of a wad of ones. And they will go to school showing off and
people like,
let me see the rest of the bills. No. Well, Carlos put a wad of 20s. Must have been $1,500 worth of 20s that he had. And he said, I made that last week. Ariel, come work for me.
No, why?
Praise the Lord that though I did not fear the Lord at that time, I feared my dad's belt. It wasn't the cops. It wasn't the Lord. It was if my dad catches me, I'm gonna be calling 911. I told Juan Carlos no. Juan Carlos was 1 year older than me, and Juan Carlos died in 1992.
Oh no.
The deceitfulness of riches may take your life too soon, but even if you never die, your soul will. And though at one time you love Jesus, and at one time you love to hear the song, Jesus loved me, this I know, the pursuit of riches. And you don't have to get seduced being a drug dealer. You just have to be seduced being successful. You have to be seduced with showing off your house, and showing off your cars, and showing off your boats, and showing off all of these material things that in the end will burn. And what have you have to show for the kingdom of heaven? Because Jesus, when he comes, he's not going to ask you, what have you done with the salary that I gave you? He's going to ask me, let me see your garden. Let me see, are there fruits? Are there fruits? Because when I sent my son Jesus some thousands of years ago, he was at the end of his ministry. And one day he was walking into Jerusalem and he saw a fig tree and he was hungry. And this fig tree was robust, big branches, big leaves. And my son goes, wow, it's not time for figs, but I'm hungry. Let me go and feed myself from these figs. And when he went and began to lift the leaves, and big leaves began to see, not one single thing. When Jesus comes, what I thought was so valuable will be so worthless on that day. That's the deceitfulness of riches. It will consume your devotional life. It will consume the mental energies that you should be devoting in knowing your Lord and Savior and serving Him. And many people will tell me, oh, Pastor, I wish I had more time to do something for the Lord. But I own a business, but really the business owns me. Watch our gardens. Watch our gardens. And having food and clothing, with these we shall be, what is that word right there, church? We shall be content. That is what money will never give you. Watch our gardens. Watch our gardens. And having food and clothing, with these we shall be, what is that word right there, church? We shall be content. That is what money will never give you. Money will never give you contentment, because money will never give you what produces contentment inside of us. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain that we can carry nothing out. Now, godliness with contentment. Contentment born out of godliness. And one of the easiest ways I heard a pastor once describe godliness is simply godlikeness. And if you want a synonym for that is having the character of Jesus Christ reproduced inside of me. And if you want to get even more theological, what it means to have God's character reproduced inside of me is the restoration of the image of God, which we were created in Genesis chapter 1. When God said, let us make man in our image, in our likeness, we lost that. And when we lost that, we lost our true worth, our true identity. And we try to supplant that by riches, by trinkets, by gold and silver that perish, while neglecting the imperishable blood of Jesus Christ that can produce in us that which is of true eternal value. Paul says that I'm not taking this suit to heaven. Praise the Lord. This suit in a couple of years will be full of little lint balls. And probably, who knows, bell bottoms will be in style again. I don't know. It will not be in style. But the robe of righteousness of Jesus, that I get to take with me. Paul says, we come with nothing and we go out with nothing. Material. But you can't come into this world with nothing, and by the intervention of the grace of God in your life,
by the prayers of your grandma, by the prayers of your parents, by the godly teaching of your parents, by you yielding your heart, you can receive godliness. Amen. And once you experience godliness, the pursuit of that which you've tried before to affirm and identify yourself with, I have this salary and I have this income and I have this degree or whatever it may be, falls to the wayside. That's why Paul says that things that I used to boast about, I count those things as rubbish. Why do I exalt about? Knowing Jesus Christ. Because he has saved me. He has transformed me. He has given me the gift of contentment. You will never have enough so that you will always be consumed pursuing riches at the expense of having all of your heart, all of your mind, all of your strength, and all of your soul so invested in this pursuit, it will choke the spiritual life out of you. And I chose those words intentionally out of the book of Deuteronomy, where God tells you, you should love the Lord your heart, the Lord your God, with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. You will not be able to have a divided love. Jesus says you cannot have two masters. You will worship the one and hate the other, or you will worship the one and hate the other. Luke 21:34, Jesus has a sobering appeal. But take heed to yourselves, lest your hearts be weighed down with carousing, drunkenness, and cares of this life, and that day come upon you unexpectedly. Jeremiah 8:20 says, the harvest is past, the summer is ended, and we are not saved. May by the grace of God, none of us ever have to speak those words. Godliness is contentment because of Jesus. Only godliness can produce contentment, because godliness means we are restored back to God's image. God's image reproduced in us through Jesus Christ restores both our identity and our worth. Building up of self no longer attracts nor enslaves me. You will never be able to, listen to this, you will never be able to possess enough riches to equal the price God was willing to pay for your salvation. You will never be worth more in this world and to this world than you are worth to God. What God compassionately paid for you, this world can never pay and will never be able to pay you. What God sees your value to be, no CEO will ever earn on planet Earth. Elon Musk was chewing his fingernails trying to see if the stock of Tesla would reach a certain point, because if he did, he would get the salary, some several hundred millions of dollars in payment. It would be such an awesome experience if Mr. Elon Musk could discover how much he's worth to heaven, how much he's worth to his heavenly Father, and what he was willing to pay to save his soul. Those millions of dollars would become chump change. As Paul said, refuse for having known Jesus. I want to exalt and praise and glorify my Savior and my Redeemer. What God paid to redeem both you and I becomes the anchor of my security and self-worth. The world can no longer entice me with what I've learned it cannot give. Listen to that last statement, church. It is the deceitfulness of riches that gets undone through the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the world will no longer be able to entice you by that which it cannot give. The word says, if you have enough riches, you will be content. And that is a lie. Only godliness will give you contentment. Only godliness will give you peace and rest, because your contentment will not be based upon your house or not your house, your salary or not your salary. Your contentment will be that there are fruits in your garden, that you have not allowed the weeds to choke out the love of God in your heart. Philippians 4, 11 and 13, Paul said, had this experience. I have learned, that didn't come natural to him, I have learned how to be content with whatever I have. I know how to live on almost nothing or with everything. I have learned the secret of living in every situation, whether it is with a full stomach or an empty stomach, with plenty or little. For I can do everything through Christ who strengthens me. That's the context of Philippians 3, 4:13. It's not that you can become a successful college graduate. It's not that you can become whatever it is that this earthly pursuits will entice you with. The context of I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me is a promise that whether you are poor or rich, you will have contentment. Whether you finish your degree or you get derailed and become a missionary, you will have contentment. I think I told you this already. Being illegal in this country for 25 years can mess with your identity, can mess with what you really believe about yourself, and definitely your self-worth. But when I found Jesus and I gave my life to him, at Mission College, I got to rub elbows with physicians from Loma Linda, nurses, and physical therapists, and my desire to learn grew as to be a missionary. I wanted to go back to school and learn so that I could give that degree to the Lord. And of course, I was single at that time, and I realized I don't want to make the irresponsible choice, the presumptuous choice of getting married and not having to be able to provide for my family. Amen. We can't take the gospel to those extremes. And God provides those opportunities. So I was like, okay, Lord, I'm going to go to nursing school so that both I can make myself available to do the health initiatives that you've taught me and be able to provide for my family. Checklist, I'm getting closer, Lord. You have to provide a wife soon. I'm getting close. So when I leave Mission College to go back to Pennsylvania to start nursing school, everything had been set. My family was excited to have me back home. Pastor Torres says, there's a little Spanish group in Columbus, Ohio. They can't afford a pastor and they can't afford an evangelistic series, but they've approached me and I've talked to the leadership of ASI and they're willing to divert some of the funds to hire some Spanish-speaking Bible workers, but they need a Spanish-speaking evangelist. Are you willing to stay there for 3 months and do this? Lord, that's one whole semester. I've been waiting, Lord, for over 20 years. My younger brother has kids already. Lord. Pastor Torres, I'll stay. I'll do it. I'll give the 3 months. Pastor Torres says, good. You'll be going to nursing school with a bang. This will be an awesome experience for you. The 3 months of the evangelistic series, and it was a 1 month and then 1 month of follow-up. When they finish, the church asked me to stay. And they couldn't pay me. I had to live with church members and live off of their refrigerator, live in their basements. The church would pay for my gas, but that was it. My parents would have to pay for my insurance, my car insurance. You know, that's a very attractive picture for a young lady looking for a husband, right? Where do you live? And that lasted for 2 years.
Wow.
Ask me if I regret giving Jesus 2 years of my life. I had to learn this too. I had to learn that it's not what you make that gives you contentment.
Amen.
It's whether you've allowed God into your life.
Amen.
With no reserves.
Amen.
I didn't have my green card. I didn't have a salary. But I would go into church members' homes to visit them, U.S. citizens, stressed out, anxious, full of troubles, failing marriages, failing lives. And they would look at me and say, I wish I was like you, Ariel. And I'm like, really? I've been trying to become like you for 20 years. How can you want to trade places with someone? And they would say, because you have peace. What Jesus says, my peace I give you, my peace I leave with you. The world cannot give you this peace. Because this peace comes through my godliness, because my godliness will give you contentment of soul. And with contentment, you get rest. And with rest, you get peace. 2 Corinthians 6:10, we are poor, yet making many rich, as having nothing and yet possessing all things. Proverbs 13:7, there is one who makes himself rich, yet has how much, church? Absolutely nothing. And one who makes himself poor, yet has great riches. And I understand those passages because of God's leading my life, and I praise him for doing that. Though I did not understand, I complained and whined. I don't want you to think that I had a little halo going, oh, thank you, Lord, that I'm standing in someone's basement. I struggled. I wept. I was angry with God. But I submitted, and I yielded, and I have no regrets for doing that for him.
Amen.
He's been so faithful with me. Proverbs 10:22, the blessing of the Lord makes one rich. It's not the money of the Lord, it's the blessing of the Lord. Sometimes it may be financial, but it will always be contentment. It will always be godliness. And he adds no sorrow with it. Ephesians 1:3, Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual gift in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Church, have you been blessed? Has God blessed you? Has God the Father been faithful to you? Can you look back at your life and now understand that some of the heartaches and some of those moments that you felt that God kept you on standby for so long were some of the greatest blessings in your life? I needed to have those experiences so that it would not be something that I learned from a book, but something that I experienced in my own life. And the psalm says, wait, wait on the Lord. It will always be worth waiting on him. Because when he gives you the blessing, no sorrow will come with it. This was an awesome day for me. Because I finally got what I was looking for. Well, I already had my green card 5 years before. But June 22, 2011 is when I became a naturalized U.S. citizen. Praise the Lord. From that day onwards, people could call me gringo, and it fit. Now, on that day, God had a special blessing prepared for me. The Honorable Hugh W. Hughes, Detroit judge that swore us in that day, had this to say to me and about 150 other non-U.S. citizens that that day onwards, we become U.S. citizens. This is what the judge said to us. Many of you have a story to tell about the journey that has gotten you to this day. I am almost sure many of you have been told about the American dream. But today, as I am about to swear you into U.S. citizenship, I must warn you. I must warn you about the American lie. Many come into this country wanting to escape poverty. They have been told in America anyone can become rich. But what they don't tell you is that in America, to pursue that lie will corrode your soul. There is a price to pursue riches, your marriage, your children, your soul. This is a judge telling us this.
That's amazing.
So, amen. So I want to tell you firsthand what the true American dream is. It is a dream founded upon a divine principle.
Amen.
The principle is found in the Judeo-Christian writings in which God speaks to a man named Abraham. God is about to bless Abraham, but before he does, God tells Abraham, I'm blessing you to make you a blessing. So you are being blessed today by becoming U.S. citizens. So I now charge you, become a blessing to others. That's the American dream.
Amen.
To be blessed so that I can become a blessing.
That's wonderful.
Be a blessing to others in this country. Be a blessing to others in this world. Today you are being blessed. So today choose to be a blessing. How many of you want to be a blessing to your family? How many of you want to be a blessing to your church? How many of you want to experience contentment in your soul? We need to surrender that which we have been trying to use to validate our worth and our identity. You are a daughter of God. You are a son of God. That identity needs to be owned by you personally. This world will not seduce when you know the lie. It will never give what it promises. Only Jesus. Only him. Father, that day, I wanted to shout amen as that judge finished charging us. I was not expecting in a secular event to have such a spiritual experience. And I don't know what everybody else heard, but I heard it loud and clear, Lord. We are sorry, Father. We want to start there. We're sorry that we have given self so much room in our garden. Forgive us, Lord, that we make such poor choices at times. Forgive that sometimes our weeds have gone into other people's gardens, mm-hmm. made more work for others because of our neglect. Forgive us, Lord. With the forgiveness, precious Father, as the master gardener, Take the weeds of self and pride from our hearts. Give us eyes to recognize that in our marriages. Give us eyes to recognize that in our relationships with our parents. Give us eyes to recognize my weeds so that your church will be weed-free. You have blessed us, Lord, with so much. Make us a blessing for each other. Make us a blessing for our homes. Fill us with your Spirit, Lord. Today is your Sabbath, and it may be relatively easy, Father, to give you this day. But Sabbath, Father, is not about us giving you one day. Sabbath is a confession of who I am. I'm worshiping my Creator and my Redeemer. He has paid my price at the cross. And today, Father, is the day in which you seek to restore that conviction so that we don't just give you today, but we give you every day of the week for you to tend our garden. So, Father, guard us when we walk into our businesses again, into our sources of employment.
Amen.
We want you to come to with us to our workplaces. Amen. That, Father, there you will bless us so that we can be blessings. That we will not allow the pollution of selfishness and pride, of an endless pursuit that will end in a nothing, to take root in the garden of our hearts. We don't want your precious plant to be choked out by our weeds. Father, tending, allowing for weeds is tending and allowing for self. Allow self to be crucified and died on a daily basis in my life and in the life of my brothers and my sisters, that anyone that can walk into this congregation can testify that there are no weeds in this garden because there are no weeds in my heart. In Jesus' name, amen, Lord. Amen.